in life than little sports. You know we're gonna play some games, and if nothing else, you know we're gonna have a laugh. We're gonna have a laugh, oh yeah, 'cause this is the podcast.
Episode 27 of the Rubber Boots Pod, brought to you by our friends at the Fandom Sports app. Now available on Android.
Perfect.
Yeah. More on that a little bit later on. A lot of our fans have been asking for that for a long time. Brought to you by idrinkcoffee.com. Our friend Slavic, very excited about TFC in the CONCACAF final.
Mm-hmm. As he should be.
And of course, Cabot Links, who sponsored our Masters episode last week. And I think that every time we started bringing them up, we got sidetracked. So I don't know that. I feel like I'm going to let them keep sponsoring us for a few weeks.
I think that's only fair.
That is so unlike us to get sidetracked.
Just to make up for it. I guess that was a couple of weeks ago because it's been a nutty couple of weeks. And I have a favor to ask of all you guys, and that's just not just you three. Stoff is here. Hi, Stoff. Lester is back.
Hey.
Puffy is alongside. But also everybody listening. I know when we started this thing, what is that, 15 months ago now, Puff?
Yeah, around there. It was like January.
We weren't sure what this was going to be. We thought there'd be a lot of interviews. That ended up being way too much work.
Interviews. I think
pop one in once a month or so.
Yeah, David Hearn exclusive last
That's right, the one-minute David Hearn exclusive.
By the way, I should tell you that before I came down here, the quizmaster asked me to let you know personally that he's available if you need to interview.
Oh, yeah, that's never good. Yeah,
well, that's what I wanted to tell him, but I thought he told me to say this off air, but I'm not doing that. Saying it on the air.
Right. So the interviews happen once in a while, and I thought maybe it would be serious sometimes. That doesn't happen very often, and mostly it's just turned into idiocy between the four of us, which is good. I'm glad it's become that.
Sure.
For sure.
But I want it to be able to also be a place where we can talk about other things. I think we share a lot of stuff about our lives here. Is that fair to say?
Oh, yeah. For
sure. We've learned a lot about each other.
For sure.
You always bring up the orgy question.
Yeah, that's
exactly.
That might have been the TSN turning point moment.
Sure. For sure.
Where we started opening up.
We started bonding.
So today I want to honor some people. And again, I know people come to this podcast as an escape, and we will have some hijinks later, I promise. We'll get into some of our regular segments a little bit later on, but I want to spend a few minutes honoring some people we lost over the last couple of weeks. Did your mom always say, like my mom, about the bad things happen in threes?
Yes.
Oh, for sure.
Right. And for sure. Which is a cliche, but it kind of feels like it happens that way. Yeah. And that's what happened. I guess we'll do this chronologically because that's the easiest way to do it. And I'm not going to, by the way, this is not going to turn into a funeral. The reason I'm doing this, I want to bring up the happy and positive sides of all these people. We were at the Masters, Puff and I, is it last week, 2 weeks ago? Puff, I'm lost. 2 weeks ago, and I guess it was day one of the Masters, Thursday. We're on the air with our bonus coverage, and I got a call from Tina from Minnesota, Jonathan's mom, that's saying that Jonathan had passed away, which caught me off guard for sure, only because I hadn't talked to Tina in a couple of weeks, and I know he'd had some setbacks, but he's had setbacks for the last...
Yeah, that's sort of...
that's his life.
Yeah,
for sure. And so you, even though we always knew that it was a possibility, I didn't see it coming that fast, and what happened is he had a couple of major setbacks and went downhill in a hurry in hospital and passed away. And that was a tough one, just because, you know, I've talked about it on the podcast before. And did you get a chance to meet him, Lester? I can't remember.
I never met him.
You never got a chance to meet him when he came into TSN. Just the most inspirational kid ever. And we had him on our Christmas show here on the pod.
Yes.
And this is going to be heartbreaking to listen to, because that was probably the most positive things had been in the last 2 years for Jonathan. If for some reason you don't know the story or haven't listened to that episode, Jonathan Pitre is a good friend of everybody at TSN. He was diagnosed with a disease called EB, which is one of the most painful diseases known to mankind. They call them butterfly children because their skin is like the skin of a butterfly, and basically any touch of it and it tears apart. And so he's sort of wrapped head to toe in bandages. He went down to Minnesota for a stem cell transplant that they hoped would ease his condition, never cure him, but let him have somewhat of a normal life. And when we interviewed him just before Christmas time, it was the most positive things had been. He had started to grow new skin, and I think the clip that Christoph's going to play was talking about walking. He'd been stuck in a wheelchair for the better part of the last few years and had finally been able to walk again.
A big milestone for us, for me. I think it was 2 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
And for the first time since we've come back, and for the first time in a long time, instead of taking my wheelchair to walk somewhere, I walked with Mom.
Ah, that's amazing.
So we went from the truck to the, from our apartment to the truck and back. And they only had to take one little breather, and that was like halfway through the first part of the walk, and I only stopped for maximum 5 seconds. And then today, I walked from the car to breakfast and breakfast to the car again. So we're really working hard. Like, I'm soon going to be able to start actual physio again. And so I'm hoping that by the time I get home, I'll be a completely new person.
That was Jonathan back in December. And unfortunately, a couple of weeks after that, he had a couple of setbacks and never really got on the road back. I went to see him at Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And, you know, still so positive and still so upbeat. But at the same time, I could tell, I think that he was just tired. You know, he just wanted to get home and be with his dog. He has a little Boston Terrier named Gibson. And he wasn't defeated in any sense, I think. Like, he still was trying, but they'd pushed back the timetable another 6 months for him to come back. So anyway, I think Jonathan's, unfortunately, the timing, and we'll get into Humboldt in a second. Jonathan passed away, and the next day it became public, and then Humboldt happened. Yeah. And I think Jonathan's story got lost a little bit, understandably, because of the size and depth of the Humboldt tragedy.
Yeah.
But I want to do whatever we can to keep his memory alive, because I think the most amazing thing that came out of this, when Jonathan was 13 a few years ago when we first met him, he lived his whole life really quietly, very normal, and then decided to tell his story. And what came out of him telling his story? Not just for him. Like, he got to do a lot of amazing things. He was a senator scout for a day. He got to come on the TSN panel. He got to go on stage at the NHL Awards. He got to meet his favorite sci-fi writer, this guy that he's read all his books. The cast of The Flash met him and sent him. All these incredible things happened to him, but he didn't really care about that. All he really cared about was raising awareness for the cause. And suddenly, you know, a lot of Canadians now know what EB is. He raised hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Sure, yeah. Like, people didn't know that disease.
So I think that's what I keep clinging to out of a positive. It is this. It's just spectacular what this guy did in 4 years. Like, more than most of us do in a lifetime, what he's accomplished.
I think the thing for me when I look at it, too, is, you know what? Here's this guy that since essentially from day one has been in pain,
mm-hmm.
and that is hard to fathom on its own. And you know, people like yourself and what we've done here, and people talking about him and talking about the awareness is really important. But you know, it just goes back for me specifically. You know, all these little things that we think are issues in our lives,
nothing.
Yeah. They're nothing. You know what I mean?
And it's just awful that it takes somebody like Jonathan to maybe make you feel better about your life. That shouldn't be what it is, but if that's something, you know, I talked to him about that. He didn't mind that.
Yeah, it's a byproduct
if he made people appreciate, you know, their lives more, that was okay with him.
Sure.
Which I think is another amazingly cool thing that he did. So we're going to miss the hell out of Jonathan Pitre, who was just an amazing, amazing kid. And our prayers go to his mom, Tina, who now has to get on with her life when she's dedicated her entire life, essentially.
That's who I was really thinking about.
Yeah,
I'm thinking about her, and you know, as much as I'm sure she's sad, part of me is, you know, I'm grateful that she's going to be able to get on with her life and do some.
That's going to take some time. I met with her in Ottawa last week. We spent some time together, and, mm-hmm. You know, she's obviously going through an awful time. Jonathan was her life for the last, but she's got a daughter, and yeah, you're right. She maybe can have some sort of normal life at some point. So We wanted to honor Jonathan today, and then so that happens. God, man, the Masters is usually my favorite week of the year.
I gotta admit, you like I think I looked at you on like Saturday.
Yeah,
I don't think I've ever seen you look so sad.
I never cared less about golf.
Yeah,
I just never had. So Humboldt happens, and that's just we sat around in our house having beers and trying to register what was happening as the updates were coming in. And I don't want to revisit the accident and everything simply because I know that as a country we're trying to heal from all this. But again, I just want to talk some things that maybe people don't know about the people involved, how amazed I am, not just the first responders in that community. First of all, if there's anything positive, and I hate when you try to find positive because it's hard to find anything positive about something like that, but the way the nation came together and sort of wrapped its arms around this community is, sometimes if you go on Twitter, you get pretty depressed about humanity.
Yeah.
And that reminds you that 95% of the people out there are really good people.
For sure.
Chris Joseph is the father of Jackson Joseph. Chris, a former NHLer who lost his son in the accident and did an amazing interview with Ryan Rashog last week, I guess, because he just wanted to talk about Jackson and what his kid was like and let people know that. And, I got to know Chris a little bit just texting after that. And, the thing that kept through the weekend at the Masters, the thing that kept coming into my head was Big League.
Yeah.
The Tom Cochran song.
Mm-hmm.
And which was about a similar type of accident. And so I called Lester. We got home for the Masters, what, Monday, Puff?
Yep, Monday.
I called Lester, I think, Monday night. Or texting him and said, I think you should do an acoustic version of Big League on the pod. We were planning on doing the pod on Tuesday, and Lester was going to do that. And then I remembered I had Tom Cochran's. We're not good friends or anything, but we've had a couple of beers together, and I had an old email from him, and Gord Miller ended up having his phone number, and I got in touch with Tom and asked him if he'd do it, and he said he would. And so we gathered the troops at TSN, the musical, the audio people, the video people, entire staff to come in Tuesday morning to do that. And it's funny, Tom changed his mind. I woke up at 6 a.m. and Tom sent me a note, said that he didn't think, he was worried that people would think that he was trying to
capitalize
somehow, which I thought was not even remotely close, but he was very worried about that. Mm-hmm. But I had talked to Chris Joseph the night before, and I had told him that Tom was planning on doing this. And he was so deeply touched by it. So I read that text to Tom, and he changed his mind and came in and did it, of course. And I just thought, sitting in that studio, listening to him play that song, I think it gets lost in Canada. It's kind of a rock anthem, right? It's people would have beers in their hands and go nuts when Big League came on. And when you hear it quiet and acoustically, it has so much more impactful, I think, the sadness and the, inspiring nature of that song.
Now, many ways out of this cold northern town, you work in the mill and get laid in the ground. And if you're gonna jump, it'll be with a game. Real fast and tough is the only clear lane to the big league. Turn some heads. My boy's gonna play in the big league. My boy's gonna knock 'em dead. Oh, the big league.
If you haven't seen the entire version of Tom Cochran doing that song, it's go to my Twitter account or just search it on Twitter. It's everywhere. But he changed the second verse.
Yep. Which I have to admit, when I was watching it, I was like, in my head, I was like, oh gosh, I hope he changes the second verse.
Yeah, well,
verse.
The original verse of the song was a little fresh. Yeah, and,
he's great.
You heard it there. He sings,
all the ride moves when he turned 18. Riding to the game, riding with his team. Riding with the friends and riding for the dreams. Riding off to immortality in the big league.
Riding to the game, riding with his team, riding with their friends, riding for their dreams, riding into immortality. Yeah. So the guy's incredibly special, and I know that at least one of the families used the song at the funeral.
Yeah.
And I heard from several of them, and Tom heard from several of them. So I'm so glad he got to do it, because it did mean a lot. I think for people of my age and Chris Joseph's age, yep, with teenage kids, you know, that was the song of our time.
Yeah,
right? That was the hockey song of Canada.
Yeah.
Mm. And so that meant a ton. And so our prayers continue for everybody in Humboldt, and it has been overwhelming to see how people have responded, not just with the money, but just, you know, the sticks out front and everything have just been
sticks,
wonderful
sticks
to see.
Out front jerseys, you know, flags,
yep,
that have masts.
And you know what? Somebody put out a note asking for broadcasters to do games next year.
Yeah, there. I saw that.
And
that's really cool.
Cuthbert said yes. Miller said yes. I'm going to bring a panel. We're going to go out and do a Humboldt Broncos game.
That's awesome.
Or multiple Humboldt Broncos games. So then this ties into the unfortunate third part of the bad thing coming threes. My dad's been ill for a while. I've been bouncing back and forth between Ottawa and here. My dad's funny. He was 87 years old and had never really been in the hospital. He got stitches once when he was 18. He got hit by a softball bat. That's the only time.
So no broken bones.
Nothing. No. Nothing. In fact, my mom found the article, because my dad was a musician and he was in the RCMP band, and she found a little article from the local paper that said, band has to cancel as Jim Duthie gets hit in head with softball bat. Requires stitches. So I've never been in the hospital, but I unfortunately got cancer, I guess, last year, and it spread really quickly and sort of went downhill. And I've been going back and forth. He was admitted to hospital in Ottawa about 3 weeks ago. So as we were on that Tuesday, as Tom was strumming his guitar and what do you call it? Sorry, Lester, I'm leaving.
Tuning his guitar,
ready to go. My sister called and said that the doctors had said it wouldn't be long. For my dad, it could be a day, it could be 2 days, it could be 3 days. They weren't sure. But he was into the last phase of his life. So, and it was funny. We had a big 90-minute preview show to do that night.
Yep.
We were doing a tribute to Humboldt, not just the Tom Cochran song, but some other things that I wanted to be a part of. And so I was stuck in that kind of work dilemma. Obviously, I wanted to be with my dad, but my sister was like, you know, do your work and come. And my dad was always a big believer in do your work.
Yeah,
I wasn't going to go to the Masters. I was sitting Saturday by his bed in Ottawa and said, I don't think I should go, Dad. And he said, if you don't go, I'm going to punch you in the face. Because I love the Masters and I love watching you on the Masters, so you're going to go and go to the Masters.
Well, there you go.
And so I went to the Masters. And I was sitting with Tom Cochran, and he said, you know, I was there when my dad passed. You should definitely go, and sort of help convince me to go. And I ran and got on a plane and got there. I guess I walked into the hospital at 4 p.m. and exactly at 8:30. So the exact moments, I guess, that Tom was strumming the opening chords of Big League on TSN, my dad passed.
Wow.
Which was, it was cool. It was, my mom is, you know, parents are so funny. They care, like, it's 8:23 or something, and my dad's, you know, he's still there, but he's into that sort of comatose state before you pass.
Yeah.
And my mom's like, you have to go watch your program, right? She wanted me to see Tom. I said, Mom, I think I'll be okay. And then because the nurse came in, and the time of death was exactly 8:30 when I figured our show was starting. But so my dad was an amazing dude. And I thought just for a couple minutes I'd tell you guys about him, because you probably haven't heard any stories about him. I wrote a big long thing on Instagram.
That was really good.
He was an interest. Like, you know, sometimes it's your father and you're growing up and you're a teenager and you're in your 20s and you really care about your life and you don't really think. And over the last few years, certainly when I started to have kids, you pay much more attention to your parents' lives and what they were. My dad was an incredible musician, Lester. It's a shame that you never got to meet him, because he played by ear, learned to play piano by ear, and was amazing at it, and played drums. Yet it was in his first band at 16, and was in bands. And he was in his last band. Their last gig was at Christmas. So he's 87 years
this
old.
This Christmas. Awesome.
Yeah, playing drums in a band called the Ardennaires.
Wow.
So they had like a clarinet player who was 90
yeah.
and a singer who was 92. And they did gigs like all around our cottage.
That's awesome.
So it was, my dad was had groupies at 87. But he was a cop too. And it's the great thing about spending time by his hospital bed in the last few weeks was my dad was a big storyteller. I think I probably got that from him. He loved to tell stories, and he started telling me stories about his old cop days. And one of his first assignments with the RCMP was they put him undercover to bust up some drug ring, and it was a band, so they got him in the band. So he was like the drummer to play some gigs with the band.
Wow.
And I don't know if it was the guy, the lead singer in the band, that was running the drug ring, or they were just delivering drugs or whatever. But so they played this gig, and then they were up in the hotel room, and they invited some girls up from the show. So like, but this is probably 1940 something, yeah. Right? Nice. My dad was born in 31, I think. So the girls come up to the room, and one of them's like, Jimmy Duthie from Kamloops. She recognized him, like she went to high school with him.
Oh my God.
And so
he's undercover.
Did he have an undercover?
Cover was like blown.
So
he like
he had an undercover name that was different than his.
Yes.
Oh my God.
So dad had to bust out, and cops came in and did the bust.
That was his last undercover assignment.
But he said that was his first big undercover assignment. He fit right in because he was a musician.
Yeah,
and this girl comes in and is like, Jimmy Duthie.
Oh my God. I was going to say, that's hilarious. I thought you were going to say, like, the drug dealer was Puffy's dad or something.
Yeah, exactly. He did, like, the move. Yeah.
And the other one, I think this was the last story my dad told me, the last real story before I left him and headed off to Augusta, was he used to do, when he got a little higher in the RCMP, he was sort of the guy when VIPs came to town who would be their sort of their escort. So he'd be in full uniform and make sure they got from place to place to place and stand by them when they're up on stage. So you'd always see my dad up on stage behind the guy. And this was the lieutenant governor. My governor generals and lieutenant governors, I'll get screwed up. But this guy was from England, I believe.
Okay.
And is there a lieutenant governor maybe that comes to Canada who represents, whatever. We'll get a parliamentarian on sometime. So they had two functions. It was in Halifax. And one was the opening of a new humane society, and one was the opening of some sort of Red Cross center. And they were out it was like a, what do they call it when you're groundbreaking ceremony, essentially.
Ribbon cutting thing.
Exactly. So they were there for the Red Cross center. So the lieutenant governor stands up to make the speech, and my dad's right behind him, and he starts going, I had this little kitty. This little kitty I loved so dearly when I was young. Animals have always been so important to me. And so my dad figured, like, a 30 seconds in, the guy was doing the wrong speech.
Yeah.
He was at the wrong event. So he's got his big RCMP boots on, and he says he starts trying to kick him in the back of a heel. Say, is this the Red Cross event? And the guy's like, my kitty meant so much to me. And he just keeps going. And all these there's 200 people, all these VIPs from Halifax in the crowd. And dad said finally he had to buckle him almost with a kick.
Yeah.
And the guy went around, turned around like this. And dad said, it's the Red Cross. Like, oh. My kitty needs blood too.
They're like people.
Yeah. But, you know, and the other thing my dad loved was football, which one of the greatest things, and I wrote a column a long time ago called Growing Up in Section G, where I say that basically everything I learned in life, I learned sitting with my dad and mom in Section G of Frank Clair Stadium, growing up watching Rough Riders games for 25 years. And that was kind of the one thing we always did together was watch football games. No matter what, I would be there every week. He never missed a game. He was the most diehard fan ever. He would sit. We would go to training camp, Puff, at Carleton University, and watch them in training camp. He would cut the training camp roster out of the Ottawa Citizen and cross out every player as they got cut.
But your dad like loved it, but he wasn't.
No,
he
was an interesting. He was a really interesting football fan because he loved it. He loved knowing the players on the team, but he didn't. know the nuances of the game very well.
Yeah.
Like I became a complete stat freak and knew, and he wasn't into that at all. He was just into
just
of winning.
Fan.
He knew the players and winning and losing. Yeah. He didn't really care about any of the other stuff. I think I've told you the story about him going to Australia.
My favorite story ever.
So Dad comes home from Australia and says, James, you're going to be proud of me. One of the 49ers, he knows I was a big 49er fan, was staying at our hotel. And I said, really, Dad? He goes, yeah, and I got him on video for you. Back with the old big Kyocera video cameras that were like 10K. So he pulls out the video, and the gentleman that he has filmed is a fairly tall black gentleman, but not remotely in football shape. Like skinny arms, big pot belly, skinny legs. And he is wearing like a Kmart Joe Montana jersey. Like it says 16 at the back, on the back. And my dad's like, do you recognize who it is? And I think I was probably 16 or 17 at the time. And I'm like, Dad, I don't know. I'm not really sure which player that is. I didn't have the heart to tell him that is not remotely a 49er.
Would be wearing his jersey.
By the pool in Australia, one of the 49ers. So God love him. Yeah, he was just a fan. And that team sucked for so long. And the thing I loved most about my dad is, I didn't love it at the time, but we would never leave a game early. And you don't know how bad Ottawa football was for 25 years. You know, that's the franchise that drafted a dead guy that had 2 9-9 years. In the 30 years, basically, that Dad and I went to games together, not 30, probably 25 years, they had 2 9-9 seasons.
Yeah.
That was the peak.
Wow.
And they would get blown out all the time. Like Doug Flutie would come into town and beat them 55-1, and the entire stadium would be empty, and Dad would always stay 0-0. And I thought afterwards, and this might sound hokey, but when I started taking my kid to games, maybe it wasn't about that. Maybe it was just about hanging out with your kid.
Yeah.
That he wanted more than anything else.
For sure. Well.
But the Red Blacks winning the Grey Cup 2 years ago was one of the greatest moments of my career, only because of my dad. It was the most nervous I'd ever been for a football game, only because I knew, he's 85. This was a surprise appearance by the Red Blacks that this was going to be it. And for them to win that game, and I called him, and I think he literally said the words, "Now I can die in peace." But you got to go to the Grey Cup this year, and there's a couple of fine young ladies, young journalists in Ottawa, twins, and they have a website and a company called Time Out with the Twins, and they do documentaries. And they did a documentary on my mom and dad and their love for football that I think I've tweeted out. I may tweet out again, but here's a clip from that.
When you get attached to a team, a game becomes much more meaningful than just going to see something. You're really involved. Something that's been so much a part of our life.
So that was my dad, Jim Duthie. I love him. I miss him dearly. We will bury him on the 28th at his beloved cottage in Arden, Ontario. And, he was also very heartbroken with Jonathan's death and the Humboldt thing. And that's the one thing he said, and I almost felt bad. People are so nice. The messages they send on Instagram and Twitter and texts and stuff from people, people are just so kind, but I almost started to feel ridiculous. I mean, my dad lived 87 years, had this amazing life.
Yeah.
And what happened to Jonathan and certainly what happened in Humboldt, those are tragedies. My dad's death was not a tragedy. It's sad, and we miss him dearly, but he knew that.
Yeah.
And made it clear that he was incredibly lucky with his life. So that was a weird couple of weeks.
So that's three, James.
Yeah, it's over.
So I think you got a pretty good little run coming up here.
Hopefully it's over for a while. Sorry, I wanted to tie those together by telling that Chris Joseph.
Yep.
And Chris Beaudry, who's the assistant coach that was not on the bus.
Yeah.
They both sent me texts about my dad. And I thought, what they're
all
going
the stuff
through,
they're going through.
Yeah. For them to think of my father passing away peacefully at 87 is that's just remarkable people.
I'll tell you, there have been a couple times in my life where I have been really. I mean, I've always been felt very, very grateful that my parents decided to come to Canada. I mean, they could have gone to the United States from Guyana. or my dad's my aunt went to England. Mm-hmm. They could have done that, but they came to Canada. And the first time I was like really like, wow, what a country!
Right,
it was actually 9/11. Yes, 9/11. I mean, don't get me wrong. There's lots of things about Canada that I really love, but 9/11 for me really reaffirmed our country, the way our country is. Like, we were giving so much blood to people in New York, we had a shortage of blood in Toronto. The stories about Gander, Newfoundland, like
Come From Away
is all about us, all about that, right? And you know, we've had tragedies and stuff like that. But when you see this country come together, at a time like this, I mean, it's incredible. And I think it's very unique to Canada.
That was the last. My dad loved theater too, and wanted to go see Come From Away. That was the one thing he wanted to go see desperately. And God, the one of the times I really bawled, my kids came down a couple weeks ago to say goodbye, and you know, my daughter Gracie's a big theater, and my dad asked her to sing for him in bed, and she sang one of her solos from one of her songs, and he was weeping and tears were rolling down her face, and I was like, oh my God.
That is pretty
that was about as emotional as it gets. But yeah, just fantastic people all around, and we're gonna go see Come From Away in his honor. My daughter saw it a couple weeks ago, said it was,
I heard it's really good,
spectacular. By the way, my buddy's from Newfoundland, and he tells me that people from Newfoundland are going into New York to see it, and they bring their little Newfoundland flags because they're proud Newfoundlanders, and they get swarmed after the show. They're rock stars.
Yeah, really?
Because they're from Newfoundland, and that's what they meant to the people in New York.
That's awesome.
Anyway, thank you, everybody. I know this was a little... I had Lester. I was worried this was going to get too depressing. Do you have a happy song you can play, Lester?
I can see clearly now.
Oh, that's better.
The rain is gone.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, you can't keep going. I just missed.
Well, you know.
Lester's songs only go about 10 seconds.
Yeah, that's right. He's the jingle king now. But thank you to all the listeners. I'm sorry that it wasn't our usual idiocy. We can get into that now.
Well, let's do it.
Why don't we get... we have a lot of Postmaster stuff to go over. Let's start with Fandom. Now available on Android, Fandom Pick a Fight. After Puffy, Puffy must have... been so successful in his test of the Android device, they said if it worked for Puffy, now everybody
able to figure it out.
If he can use it,
anyone can.
So I think our most common responses on Twitter to Fandom are "Where's my freaking book?" because I hadn't sent them, and "When are you coming to freaking Android?" And now I don't have to answer that one anymore.
So one for two.
One for two.
And so, now that we're on this playoff schedule, you'll have a few. Free time to
nothing but
books.
Time, nothing but time to send out books.
So I saw somebody on Twitter, I guess, won a second time.
Yes,
and he signed it like ripping their brother or something.
Yeah, he asked me to rip his brother.
Yeah, that was well done,
which is nice.
Yeah.
Yes.
So here's the deal: on the Masters edition of the pod, we asked this Fandom question: would you rather have one green jacket, win the Masters, the most prestigious, likely of most golfing events, mm-hmm. or would you like to win all the other three majors?
Yes.
Everybody weighed in. I then got caught up with all the other stuff that was happening.
For sure.
And forgot to post the question on Fandom.
Yeah, it happens.
So, I mean, it's still topical.
So, I continue to screw up our sponsors royally. So, I will put that question up this week for the people who wanted to weigh in. And we thought we'd throw up one other question for you. And would you want to do the injury one?
Or sure, we can do that one.
Okay. So... Puffy came in today. This is Tuesday, as usual, taping on Tuesday. You're probably listening on Thursday or the weekend. And said, "I hate Brad Marchand. I want him hurt. I want someone to kill him.
I want him dead. I want his family dead. I want his house burnt to the ground."
Not kill, but
not
hurt.
Kill. Not kill, but get him out of the series.
Yes. Out of the series.
I don't like him.
All right. Are you in favor of, we'll work on the wording of this, if your favorite team is playing another team, one of your players knocks the other guy out of the series? Marcus Foligno had that questionable whack on Tyler Myers.
I think that was... people were trying to...
Yeah, I know. I agree that shouldn't have been a suspension, but would you...
I want it to be more obvious with my...
So you're not going to... We're not celebrating violence in a sense. No permanent damage. We don't want anybody hurt. But... knocked out of the series. Are you okay with one of your players making a dirty play to knock an opposing player out of the series?
Yes.
That will be our question. Lester, are you okay with that?
We're talking.
What about the Habs against Marchand instead of the Leafs?
Well, we're talking Bobby Clark and Valley Harlemont.
Right. Were you okay with that? I still feel a little bit dirty about that one.
It was very dirty. Listen, it's one of the dirtiest things I've ever seen in any hockey game.
But everybody celebrates
Bobby
Clark. Go out and
break his ankle.
Yeah.
You know?
Legend.
What would you do? I mean, different times. You know, listen, though. No. Honestly, and this is Serious Lester, but I'd rather win. I'd rather beat their best.
Serious Lester. Not Puffy.
No.
Win at all costs.
If Marchand would do it to us, we'll do it to him first.
I want to see. I want to see him across the other side of the rake crying because he lost Game 7 to the Stanley.
I'm fine with him being in the press box. Well. They shake hands.
Or the hospital.
So we'll put those two questions up. You can answer our master's question, and you can answer that one as well, and we'll give away a couple of books next week. The master's edition of the pod was, as predicted, a disaster. Puffy, yeah. A lot of people noted, seemed extremely drunk.
That's not true.
And we love their women.
And we take.
No, we do not.
Oh, no,
we
don't
do that. We don't do that.
We don't do that.
And we were drinking beer.
No, we never did that.
1987. We loved women.
Wow.
I could testify to the fact that he was not extremely drunk.
No.
He was a little tipsy.
I was not on the clock, James. That was my time.
Talking like this all time.
Yeah, I would say that's the drunkest I've been on the podcast.
Awesome.
Best is I was more sober after we came back.
I know. I thought
I was still
the pod. I think our poor listeners thought I kind of teased them at, we're going to be back in 4 more hours and it's going to be nuts. And then we got back and everybody was sober.
Yeah. We just pounded steak and a couple beers.
That's right. We got all the. I think that happens, though. Don't you find that if you're a little, if you drink on an empty stomach,
yeah,
and then you pound down a big meal,
yeah,
you feel better. You recover.
Definitely leveled me off
for sure. Makes sense.
So Bump and Run were on the pod.
Yes, they were.
Right. I thought it was actually probably Bump's best performance on the pod.
Really? Yeah.
And he's had some bad ones.
No, terrible, this usually.
I thought he was outstanding. So this was from the Jay and Dan pod last night. Dan had a little NASCAR experience on the weekend.
Yep.
So listen to what came up on his podcast.
And you shot these promos with Bark and Fitz, is that right? The NASCAR mascots?
The race mascots were named Bump and Run.
Oh, Bump and Run. That makes more sense than Bark and Fitz.
And they both had reverse boners because their tails were erect, but protruding from where a tail would protrude from. But Bump had a big barrel.
No.
Big barrel. We were trying to determine if it was part of the costume or if it was a real life belly.
Oh, it's real life.
Yeah, it's real life. We can confirm it. And he doesn't usually have a boner. It's not a reverse one.
We saw it a lot.
Yeah, we did. He's not very shy about it.
So Bump and Run might have to sue. Their namesakes have been stolen by NASCAR.
NASCAR will sue them.
Exactly.
Maybe.
I think NASCAR might predate the old Bump
NASCAR's
and Run.
NASCAR's lawyers might be a little more, a little stronger than the Bump and Run lawyers.
Well, that's fantastic.
That's great.
What else was what happened at the Masters? So I was a bit of a mess, as I told you. I wasn't really good at focusing on golf because of the other stuff that was going on.
Listen, I'll tell you right now. I'll say this to you. I'm looking right at you. I thought you did a great job. And I knew what was going on. So.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I didn't have to do that much, frankly. There was a lot of live golf, and we'd come on and do two-minute segments in between. But I did have a porn moment. We've talked about the porn moments.
Porn?
I'm like, did you say porn?
That's what I thought I heard.
I think last season we talked about the great porn moments in the history of TSN broadcasting. Led by Gino Redis.
Gino Redis, definitely number
one. Gino Redis, ultimate World Juniors 2003. Brendan Bell skating into the boards, into the camera.
Sully.
And Gino using this unfortunate line. Welcome back to the World Juniors on TSN. There's Brendan Bell coming in your face all night long. So we were talking about Rory McIlroy. This was Sunday before the round had started and his chances. I was speaking to David Hearn, our analyst, and Bob Weeks about the fact that Rory had on the PGA Tour 3 shot deficits before and come back to win. And I said this:
he does have a history of coming back. He's come back from 3 strokes down 3 times to win tournaments on the PGA Tour. So he's done it from behind.
No, he's done it all sorts of different ways, whether it's PGA Tour or majors, and I think that's the big advantage he has over Patrick Reed.
He's done
it from behind. Which other ways, Bob?
He's done it from behind.
So, okay. I think this is
fair.
This is where we reveal ourselves as immature people on television. Usually there's silly pornographic references.
Yes.
But in this particular moment, David Hearn... it's funny, when you're on television, you can hear when the visuals are on. So we were not on camera at the time, but there's about a second delay. So Dave, when as soon as I said that, sort of turned to the camera and made this funny wide open eyes face. And he thought we weren't on, but because of the 1 second delay, we actually were on camera. And it's a terrible podcasting, but I'll show you guys the shot. It was pretty spectacular. And there it is. What, as a matter of fact, you know the faces option of So I guess
should be his new Twitter.
I'll put
avatar.
This out on the Rubber Boots Pod account on Instagram.
Yes,
David Hearn's reaction to me saying whatever.
He's done it from behind.
Yes, he has.
Okay.
Okay. Hey, you know what we got to do? Still with the Masters, we had a ready-made edition of A-OK or A-Hole. By the way, time to debut our new jingle from Lester McLean for A-OK or A-Hole.
Is it A-A-A-A-A-Hole or is it A-A-A-A-OK?
That's very church-like.
It does. Yeah,
it has a religious feel to it. So it's A-Hole or A-OK, not A-OK or A-Hole.
A-Hole or A-OK.
A-Hole or A-OK is brought to you by our friends at idrinkcoffee.com, the number one place for you to buy coffee online. You can buy espresso machines. It has coffee from all over the world. It's fantastic. And the owner of the company is very excited right now because his team is about to win the CONCACAF.
Whoa, James.
Don't get ahead of ourselves. This edition of, do you want to explain or should I, Puff?
A-hole. You can explain it.
All right. So this is basically, this is the rare one that Lester and Stoff can actually just answer for us.
Okay.
You guys can be the judge.
It's a real life scenario.
Real life situation. So Puffy and I and Bump and Run, we wake up early to drive to Charlotte to get our flight home from the Masters. Our flight from Charlotte gets canceled. We get notification of this early. So we decide to drive. We end up driving to Atlanta, essentially.
Yes.
There is an 11 o'clock flight, and there is a 4 p.m. flight.
Yes.
From Atlanta. We believe we're all on the 11 o'clock flight. Mr. Wolf, Nicole,
yep.
has She's told us.
Working. She's trying to
she
get
She is trying to get us on. And Madeline, our travel person, yep. our other Mr. Wolf, also trying to get us on the flight. So, halfway to Atlanta, we get the following email from Madeline. Guys, there's only one ticket left on that flight. I can get James there in business class, but I can't get you guys on until the 4. So, James,
yep.
good guy, team guy, good guy, good
time,
guy, team guy.
At this time, I agree.
He's no Bobby Orr.
So, I write back, we'll all go on the 4. It's fine. We'll all go on the 4.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's copacetic. Kumbaya, team's team. We're fist bumping each other. We're going to do the 4. Then the tickets start to come in.
Yes.
Get the little beeps on the phone. Doo-doo. Tickets coming in. Bumps on the 4. Yeah. Runs on the 4. Puffs on the 4. Doo-doo. Jimmy's still on the 11. Now we're an hour outside of the airport.
Yeah. And we're tight. We're tight to make that 11.
We're tight to make that 11. So she didn't read my email right, and she still booked me on the business class on the 11.
Or did Jimmy send another email saying, ignore the email I just sent, I'm on the 11.
I'll take the 11.
There was a lot of suspicions. That did not happen. But now at this point, I decide, screw these I'm taking the 11. It was the allure. Because I didn't want to write her back now again. Now that she's booked the ticket.
Yeah, well, can't go back.
I can't go back. The guys in the car, right away, they said, A-hole or A-OK? Stuff? Thoughts?
I think it's okay. I mean, as long as you didn't send that second email, like Puffy's insisting you may have, I'm willing to believe you haven't. So I think it's A-OK, you know, a little first class, why not? It's not like you bumped them out of first class, right?
The greatest thing was when I landed, I was in the cab back to my house, and I sent Puffy a text about something else, and he said, wait a second, you're already there?
We are still living at the airport.
Lester?
I think you're absolutely 100% fine on this as well.
I cannot believe you guys.
Dinner.
We were a team all going to the same destination.
Hold on. He has said very clearly, publicly, that we're going to go as a team by the 4 o'clock flight. It is not his fault that those instructions weren't followed.
It's his fault when he sends a follow-up email insisting that okay. the note thing
I really no, 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 didn't no. send up the email, but that would have been a brilliant play, and I immediately regret it. To be fair, I could have easily said, like Maddie could have made an easy chin. I could have just said, ah, Maddie, just switch it back. I'm going to go with these guys. I'll hang out with these guys in the airport for 4 hours. So I felt a little a-hole-ish.
No.
But in the end, as soon as I got home and I was knackered on my couch... I felt A-okay.
I'll never forget you walking away, looking back at us in the car as we had to go tune around for another 3 hours.
I wouldn't look back. I would just get going. That would have been an move.
It was a solid five. That's a five-hour gap, though. That was a big. Sure. I felt really good when I got on that plane.
But what's the cost of canceling it to book a coach?
Oh, I don't think it would have cost her anything. We booked so much travel.
Yeah?
Wouldn't have been any cost. It just would have been...
Really? You
know, it would have cost me a half a day.
We had a great day at the airport, though. So.
You guys had so much fun?
We did. We surfed our phones.
Anyway, A-OK or A-Hole is brought to you by iDrinkCoffee.com. We have too... You know what, Lester? We have too many jingles.
Middle of the morning, can't keep my eyes open because I got to have a cup of Java. I got to have a cup of Java. So I better log on. To iDrinkCoffee.com.
Play the theme at the end.
iDrinkCoffee.com.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, you always forget that last part.
I always jump the gun on that.
That might
one.
Be my number one favorite now.
Really?
Yeah, it's really climbed the charts. Yeah. Come on, strong.
The iDrinkCoffee.com people love it.
They love it? Okay,
yeah.
That's good.
Yeah. They've started using it now without your permission.
Really? Well, surprise, surprise.
Go on the site. It's the first thing you hear now.
Can I tell you something very quickly? And this sort of ties in. I've been doing some work.
A-hole or acceptable? iDrinkCoffee.com uses the song without your permission. Sorry.
Do 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 do. What song?
Don't do that. That
no.
is.
Come on, the commies are in town.
No.
Uh oh. No. Say it again.
Do 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 do.
Can't touch the
Can't touch the super freak.
Well, it's the same thing. That's why they mix those songs.
No, well, I guess
don't
they do.
Turn around. Uh oh. The commies are in town. Uh
oh. Went to that song.
Can't touch.
Oh, I know that song.
Apparently, I'll say this. This is a gentleman by the name of Peter Cardinelli. He's a very, very well-known bass player and producer in Toronto.
Right.
He wrote that bass line. And did not get credit for it from Rick James. He produced
that.
Yes. He wrote that.
Oh, that's a real good bass
line. That's the whole song, right? So not only did he get ripped off once with Super Freak, he got ripped off again when it came out with Can't Touch This.
Like, he'd be probably worth millions.
What do you think?
Credit for it.
What do you think is going to be our thing that gets sampled? Something's going to get sampled by somebody. Could be the Rubber Boots Guy song, could
that
be the I Drink Coffee theme.
Very good.
Something could get sampled along the way.
Yeah, for sure. One of these little...
Let's do... this is not a Lester version. Lester ripped off these guys, a little group called Van Halen, It's Dreams.
So baby, dry your eyes. Save all the tears you're crying. Oh, that's what dreams are made of.
Second half of this podcast has basically been just playing all Lester's songs. All the segments have been that short.
He could honestly have an album. It would be very short.
I know.
But he could have an album.
We don't have any content anymore in between. We just play them. And this will follow that because I had this dream last night. And I thought I'd share it with you again. It's not that entertaining, but I thought you'd enjoy it because it's soccer themed.
Oh.
In the dream last night, both you and I were on TFC.
I hope that we're playing Houston and not the CONCACAF game.
No, we're playing CONCACAF.
Oh, no.
So it's the CONCACAF thing. But here's what happens. If we win the game, then for some reason, I had heard a conversation about CONCACAF, and I guess there's a tournament they play in this world tournament in Dubai or something, right? That's what happens if they win. But in my dream, they were going to row against Oxford. You know
also
that Oxford-Cambridge big rowing thing every year?
I'd love to go to that.
So TFC was going to row against Oxford. Okay. That is what the CONCACAF thing was. And so we had our coach was not...
Vanny.
It was not Vanny. It was a female coach.
Oh, nice.
And we were having these warm-ups and practices, and she was trying to pick the rowing team.
Okay.
Right? And I was bad-mouthing. So the other people on the team, like... Michael Bradley was on the team.
Okay.
Javanko was on the team. Josie was on the team. Yep. But then some of the other team were like guys in my life. Mike Thibodeau, this kind of chubby pothead I went to high school with.
Nice.
Mark Ward, one of my soccer buddies with a giant forehead.
Yep.
He's on the team. Puffy's on the team.
Nice.
And I'm on the team. Sorry, Lester, you're not on the team. Stoff is not on the team.
Wow.
But I can't believe you get ignored in your dreams, too.
I know.
I'm really good at rolling, so it's a shame.
Stop taking the shorts.
So I was just completely bad-mouthing all of you to the coach.
Oh, of course.
Which made me question my entire character.
Yeah.
Like, I basically said, I remember saying distinctly, Puffy's too lazy to be on this crew.
I would drag the boat down.
Huh? Right, and I was showing off. I was telling her I could bench 380 pounds, which I can't.
No.
And I was saying Michael Bradley's too skinny to row.
True.
And
Ipsy wouldn't have a lot of good coxswain.
Right.
Is that what they're called?
Like Michael, yeah, Javanko could be that little. What's the guy's name? The coxswain
in the
front?
The one who
Yeller? I think that's the official name.
Official name is Yeller.
Yeller.
There's a lot of coxswain and
when he gets
Yeller.
Old, he's old Yeller.
They're thinking, oh, that guy, is that would be our best bet for a gold medal in the Olympics is to be the cox guy? The coxswain.
Yeah, I think that's your best bet.
Right.
Because what do you have to do?
You just have to be little. you have to be light. No, you probably have to call
it like
strokes.
Failed jockeys? Yeah.
There's strategy involved, definitely.
Well, he's got to pick up the pace. You got no one to pick up the pace.
See if we can get a coxswain on the show who also analyzes.
You already have one, James.
I'm not talking about
Bright Stuff.
That's too simple.
What happened in the end?
Yeah, like
we lost.
Did I make the trip to? Did I make
no.
crew?
No,
I want to know if I made crew.
You didn't make crew.
You actually sunk me.
The thing was, I can remember distinctly that we had 1,400 pounds,
yeah.
And so that's Oxford was just going to have seven rowers who weighed 200 pounds each. But I asked. I said, can we have like 10 rowers that weigh 140? Would that be it?
Yeah, probably.
And
with a calculator,
because that way we could
these.
Get Javanko and Bradley in there rowing. And they said that was legal, and so I was trying to negotiate for that, and then we lost, and we didn't make it. And I remember, again, just blaming all you guys, like yelling, it's your fault, Puffy, and then I woke up in a cold sweat.
But also with the satisfied grin that you were right.
That's right. So that's our podcast for this week. We didn't do
some
of it.
Seems like you've been an the last little bit with these dreams, with us leaving us at airports.
I know.
That's funny.
No, I was voted A-OK by the two members of the jury.
I think if you put that out on the Twitter, people will trounce you.
No, they won't. For the flight thing?
Yeah, the flight thing, I think people will sign.
But you see, it's too long to tweet because you have to have the background. If you just say, Duthie takes the early flight, leaves the other guys, then I'm going to get trashed. But if you have the background of all those emails and the fact that I wanted to go with you guys, then I don't think so.
Would you show your outbox from that date to me?
Yes, I would. I will reveal. You have full control of my phone.
And then I want to see your deleted box.
Wow.
If it was there, I'd be so happy.
Would you though?
It would be one. I think.
No,
I would
what
rather,
would that do to our relationship? Do
you, I think
if that was actually there, would you be happy, or now would you never trust me?
I would rather
again?
Know. I'd rather see that than know what's in Al Capone's vault.
Yeah, but you could go the other way too. I mean, you can show them the text, but you'd never feel the same.
Then you'd feel I never
trusted you.
You
feel violated, right?
Yeah.
I mean, to me,
we can't go down that road.
Do you guys?
Someone's getting hurt either way.
Is this the hill you guys want to die on?
No, it's not.
Because then the orgy would never happen.
Yeah.
Post-orgy,
maybe.
From season one. Coxswain.
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 Oh.
So that's a term that we don't use enough in sports.
Yeah, I think there should be a coxswain in all your lives, like in everyday life.
Wow. Could we change to bring it into the pod?
Someone just here to yell at us?
No, just give a nickname. He was the one who said the thing. So,
yeah.
Welcome to episode 28 of the Rubber Boots Pod. I'm with Puffy Stoff and Coxswain Lester.
Coxswain Lester. Works for me.
Thanks for listening again, everybody. Thanks for indulging in the stuff off the top. I know it was a little heavy, but The one thing I haven't been able to do, because you get so busy after something like this happens, is haven't really been able to talk about it too much. So wanted to talk about my dad, wanted to talk about Jonathan, wanted to talk about all the kids from Humboldt and all the fine people around them. Let's hope better days are ahead for all of us and the Rubber Boots guy.
Hey, how are you? I got a question that I really wanna ask you. Wait, don't hang up. I need to know, so I'm gonna try and push my luck. Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Are they purple, yellow, green, blue, black, or white? Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? And do you like the dunk tank at the fair? I know it's a little strange, my obsession with your choice of footwear in the rain. I know that you're on TV, but I need you to put your boots up on the desk for me. Are you wearing your Hawaii boots tonight? Are they purple, yellow, green, blue, black, or white? Are you wearing your Hawaii boots tonight? And do you like the dunk tank at the fair? This is the part they call the bridge, up which has water under it. With rubber boots you can wade in the water. Just don't fall in.
Don't fall in, don't fall in, don't
fall in. Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? Are they purple, yellow, green, blue, black, or white? Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? And do you like a dunk tank at the fair?
Do you like the dunk tank
at the fair?
The dunk tank, the dunk tank
at the fair. Are you wearing your rubber boots tonight? No, seriously, are you wearing your rubber boots? Don't hang up, please, somebody. Anyone?